Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, psychologist, professor, author, blogger, podcaster, and your host. Today, our topic is telehealth. There's no doubting that the world has changed as a result of the novel coronavirus. As of the recording of this show in mid-April 2020, most of the country and the world is practicing social distancing and even sheltering in place. For many of us, the pandemic has brought many firsts. The first time we've worn a face mask or covered our mouth and nose with some other kind of cloth to protect against infection. The first time we've had a conversation with someone standing 6 feet apart. Or the first time we've celebrated a birthday via video chat. But for many, it has brought yet another first. Our first virtual meeting with a physician, psychotherapist, or other healthcare professional. Known as telehealth, remote meetings with healthcare professionals have quickly become the new normal. But how much do you know about how these appointments go, how they change the way healthcare happens, and how to best prepare for them? Today, we'll talk with a physician as well as a mental health professional about how to best utilize telehealth. My first guest, Dr. David Stukus, joins us by phone today from Columbus, Ohio, where he is an associate professor of pediatrics in the Division of Allergy and Immunology at Nationwide Children's Hospital and the director of the Food Allergy Treatment Center there. Among many other accolades, Dr. Stukus is known for his social media presence. In 2018, Dr. Stukus was invited to become the first social media medical editor for the American Academy of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology, where he produces and hosts their podcast, Conversations from the World of Allergy. He has also been named a top doctor in pediatric allergy every year since 2015. Dr. Dave, as his patients call him, is very active on social media and uses his popular Twitter and Instagram accounts, Allergy Kids Doc, to dispel myths and combat misinformation. Dr. David Stukus, welcome to About Health.
Thank you so much. It is an absolute pleasure to be with you today, and I really appreciate the opportunity to have this conversation with you.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you here. I wonder if we could start with just a simple definition. What is telehealth? It's a term that gets thrown around a lot these days in the medical profession, but it isn't used as often by non-medical folks. So what does telehealth encompass?
Telehealth really encompasses just the generic form of delivering some sort of service remotely. It's a little different than telemedicine, which is you're actually giving clinical care remotely. But if you think about it, we've been doing this for decades. It's when you have a telephone call with a patient. So if anybody listening has ever called their doctor with a question, and they've called you back and they've discussed your care and made some recommendations, that's telehealth. And there's different formats that we're going to get into as we discuss further. But really, that's all that general term refers to.
So it can be via phone. It can be also via video, right? Are there other formats as well?
Yeah, really, those are the two main ones. So both telephone and then televideo are the two formats that we would use. And of course, they differ because over the phone, you can't see the other person. And by video, you have audio and video where you can actually see them, do a physical exam, and make semi-eye contact, I guess you can say.
So what percentage at this point, now that we're sheltering in place, of your patients, or I guess I should say of patients in general that come to the hospital or go to doctors, are being seen via telehealth now?
That's a great question. And if you ask that question, you're going to get a different answer depending upon who you speak with. I work at Nationwide Children's Hospital, which is a major tertiary care pediatric academic medical center. And we switched almost exclusively to telehealth visits about 3 weeks ago as a way to really keep our patients and families safe, as well as our staff as well. But if you talk to somebody who's in private practice, especially who's been more established or they have different patients that they see, they may only have half their visits or none of their visits. So it really does depend upon who you speak with, whether it's primary care, specialty services, adult providers, pediatric providers, what type of services they give and they use, as well as their capabilities just to set telemedicine up in their office and make it, practical and usable.
So it sounds like if a person is listening to this and is thinking, well, you know, I need to see my doctor and I wonder if they do telemedicine or telehealth or will meet with me by phone, the thing to do is to email them or call their office and ask, right?
Oh, absolutely. And this is evolving rapidly. What may have been in place a week ago may no longer be the case this week. With this COVID-19 global pandemic, it's really fascinating. Almost all of us are under these shelter-in-place orders, but if you look at community-wide spread, it does differ based upon where you are, even within the same state or the same county.
Sure.
When it comes to traditional outpatient care visits, if you're going to your physician's office or nurse practitioner, whoever it may be, a situation in a rural area may differ from somebody who is in Manhattan right now. So it really is highly variable.
Sure. I wonder, just out of curiosity, as you're talking, I'm wondering how this has affected, particularly where you are at Nationwide Children's, which has really gone all in with telemedicine. How has this affected the total number of appointments? I mean, in some sense, it's easier to access providers via telemedicine than to go in. Has this raised or lowered the total number of appointments, or is it the same number, it's just changed the medium?
Yeah, there's a bit of a learning curve. So we all had to adapt very rapidly. In my state of Ohio, we were one of the first states to adopt more of a widespread shelter-in-place order and social distancing, things like that. So we kind of saw this coming, and we had the foresight and the support from our administrators at the hospital to really get things up and running as fast as we could. Whereas other places, it may sort of lag behind a little bit, and people may have just sort of stopped coming in for their visits. So that being said, we actually looked at our numbers recently, and compared to this point last year, from the start of the year until where we are in mid-April, we're only down by about 40 patient visits this year with implementation of telehealth over the last several weeks compared to last year. So we're sort of on par with where we were. And for us, I'm a pediatric allergist, this is our busy season. Spring tree pollen season is miserable for millions of children and adults. And that's when our phones ring off the hook. So we're still trying to deliver as much care as we possibly can.
Yeah, I mean, it's good to know that, even though there's been a pretty big shift from the public standpoint in terms of how they see their doctors, particularly, I imagine, in Ohio and in California, two states which have really embraced shelter in place and embraced it early, that there's still pretty good access, or at least as good access as there was before. So let me ask you, from the perspective of a physician, and as a pediatric allergist, you're seeing mostly kids, of course, and their families. What do you see as the challenges of seeing patients via telehealth, so on video, on the phone, versus in person? How does it change the way you do things?
Well, first and foremost, the biggest challenge surrounds the technology as well as the reimbursement. And that was the major hurdle for a lot of folks. Telemedicine has been used really for decades, including video over the last, several years. And with my specialty, allergy and immunology, it's sort of been well established that this can be a very effective way to deliver care for chronic conditions such as asthma, allergic rhinitis, seasonal allergies, things along those lines. So we've already been doing this in our specialty. But the reimbursement hasn't always been universal. It's gone state by state. It's changed by payer, if it's Medicaid versus, commercial insurers. There's a lot of hurdles in regards to just, how do you do these visits and get reimbursed? And then you have the technology. So you have to have, there's dozens of platforms. So from the provider end, you have to figure out what platform do you want to use? Is it secure so that we can guarantee patient privacy at all times? How does that integrate with somebody's electronic medical record? Things along those lines. So there's a lot of little tiny logistical things that need to be overcome. And what this COVID-19 pandemic has forced all of us to do is adapt and be flexible. And we have seen such resounding support from the state legislatures and insurers and payments and reimbursement that now everything is essentially covered. Yeah. So we just blew through all those barriers all at once, as opposed to sort of a slow rollout, piecemeal approach, state by state. So those are the biggest hurdles that we had to overcome in order for any of us to really get this up and running.
So let's talk about cost for a minute. We've been talking about insurers, and it's really great to know that insurers, have kind of stepped up. And so I'm assuming that most people who have, any kind of decent health insurance are going to be able to, you know, use telemedicine, are going to be able to have a virtual appointment with their doctor. But of course, there are a lot of people out there still who are not insured and who are paying out of pocket. So it may be a hard question to answer because I'm sure the answer is a big, it depends. But what about for people who don't have insurance? Is there a cost differential, cost advantage, disadvantages for telehealth over a traditional visit?
Well, yeah, you hit the nail on the head. It really does depend. It depends on who you're seeing, the state you're in, and what the purpose of the visit is and how things have been established. But there have been models in place for years where it's sort of like a concierge medicine type effect, where you pay either a monthly fee or a fee for service, where you can get a physician by telehealth and video, you know, on the phone, almost on demand, if you're willing to pay cash or credit card or whatever it may be to have that service. So these things have really been established in with different models for quite a while now.
What about for people who are on Medicare, Medicaid? Is that generally also something, you know, they can avail themselves of telehealth as well in most places?
Right now, yes. If you had asked me that question, you know, 2 months ago, the answer was probably no, or it depends. But again, it really has changed dramatically and for the better for all of us.
Well, I'm David B. Feldman, and my guest is Dr. David Stukus, director of the Food Allergy Treatment Center at Nationwide Children's Hospital in Columbus, Ohio. And we're talking about how the coronavirus pandemic is changing the way we connect with healthcare professionals. Because this is a pre-recorded interview, we're unfortunately not able to take calls today. So let's talk a little more about telehealth from the patient's perspective. We've been talking about, you know, seeing a doctor virtually, and most of our conversation so far has involved video and phone. So I guess I have a couple of questions here. First is one better than the other, video or phone, you think, from the physician's perspective and perhaps from the patient's perspective? And my next question is, where do emails fit into this? Personally, I find myself frequently emailing my primary care doctor with questions. How would a patient know which medium is best for them given whatever problem they're facing?
I think they have to have that conversation with their personal physician. I also utilize email, or we have secure messaging called MyChart through the electronic medical record that we use. And I love it because these are for non-urgent questions and or updates from people that you've known, you know, usually well-established relationships for months to years. It's just a quick, hey, what do you think about this? Which is very different than an acute concern. I need to speak to somebody right now because I'm having these symptoms. I'm not sure what to do about it. So that's a great way to communicate on their schedule, on our schedule. And there's an understanding that if you send your communication that way, say through email or through this, you know, secure message in the electronic medical record, that I will get back to you within 24 hours, which is very different than if you're calling the on-call physician where you expect to call back within minutes. So we have to really lay the foundation to make sure the expectations are there of here's when you use this one, here's when you use that one. That's going to vary by condition. That's going to vary by person. But those are some things to consider. But I agree. I think that they can work out very well.
So it sounds like the general advice is, look, if you've got something, it's not terribly urgent, sending a secure message through one of these sort of email portals to your doctor is a reasonable thing to do. If you're not sure, though, it sounds like the best option is to call the doctor's office, to call the hospital, to talk to whoever's available to speak to, and to ask that question to them, right?
Yes. You know, ideally, this conversation takes place sort of preemptively and proactively when you either meet somebody or when the physician or provider really changes, you know, their approach to this. I will say that not all of my colleagues are comfortable with this approach, and you're going to see that variability in regards to comfort level from email communication, secure messages, the capability to do it, even with telemedicine. Just some people just don't adopt very well to the medium. So as you mentioned a couple of times now, which is very important, call your doctor's office. We've had messaging services for years, and you know that's how you get a hold of somebody. So call and talk to them. A lot of practices now with the COVID-19 pandemic are being proactive, and hopefully most of the practices have websites and they have even social media channels where they're putting out updates and putting out information and being proactive to let their patients know how they're going to continue to meet their needs, although it may just have changed a little bit. And then to go back to your first question, if I may, you asked, sure. You know, what's the preferred method? And I would say video is preferred. It's always preferable to see somebody. You know, while we may not be able to do a complete physical exam, we're all trained to take, you know, important findings from the physical exam. Sometimes we can see things through the video or just even the nonverbal cues. So it's the response to a question. If I make a statement or a question, and when they may say one thing with their words, but when I look at them, if their demeanor says something else, that speaks volumes. Especially, you're going to speak to somebody about using this for behavioral health, and you know better than anybody. I think that's an important aspect to consider as well.
Right. So if you ask someone, you know, are you in pain, and they say, oh, no, not really, but they're grimacing and they're favoring one side of their body while they're saying it, perhaps that gives you some indication that they're one of those people that sort of tends to downplay pain. Is that the kind of thing you're talking about that's sort of more useful on video?
Absolutely. That's a great example. Yep.
So let's talk about what a typical visit is like. And take me through a typical video telehealth visit. How is the connection established for people who may be a little technophobic? How long is this kind of appointment? What transpires? And how is it similar to, because I imagine it's largely similar to, but also how is it different than an in-person office visit?
Let's start with the similarities, because it really is like going to the doctor in many ways, except it's just from the comfort of your home or work or wherever you may be. So ahead of time, you may have forms to fill out. We still need to make sure that you have up-to-date insurance and contact information. Has anything changed? You know, a lot of us, when we go to the doctor's office, we have a couple of forms we have to fill out, whether it's we go once a year or every time we go. Anything different with your past medical history? Anything different with the environment where you live? Any concerns with your health, anything different with your medication. So you have to prepare ahead of time and make sure that you have all of those things filled out before the actual time of your visit. And that's going to, you know, vary a lot based upon the practice you're going to and the requirements they have and things like
that.
And
that'll be sent to you via email or through one of these healthcare portals.
That's right. Yep. So we'll get everybody ready to go ahead of time. And ideally, and you know, this is what we do, is we contact you ahead of your visit, generally several days or a week before. This is the format we're going to use. We give you the link to the technology that we use. So you have to, you know, there's different platforms out there. If you're using one platform, but your provider's using another, that's not going to work because they won't speak to each other. So you have to make sure you have the right one. And then you have to register. So when you go in, you give your insurance card. Sometimes there's a co-payment involved, and that can be the same situation via telehealth as well. So you register, and then you get roomed. You know, it's typically not you walk in and you sit in the waiting room for a little bit, and the doctor's going to come out and see you in the waiting room. You know, generally a nurse or a medical assistant comes out, and they get you, and sometimes oftentimes in the office will take your vital signs, ask some introductory questions and background information as well. You know, generally do an initial assessment. So that's something that we do actually is our registration person will talk to the family and then they'll kind of go in a holding pattern. Then our nurse will actually enter the room or the portal and they'll talk to them and they'll sort of do all the rooming questions. There's a lot of important questions to ask, especially now. Do you feel safe at home? You know, things along those lines. There are things that we're going to pick up that, you know, I'm not going to pick up during my interview.
Good point.
Yeah, and then, you know, it's really just like being at the doctor's office, except, again, you're in the comfort of your own home. So we can see each other. It's interesting because you need to prep a little bit ahead of time. So there's some tips on our end as the medical professionals of don't look at the person, look at the camera. Because if you look at the person, you're not making eye contact with them. And you want to have good lighting, and you want to be in a quiet environment with limited interruptions. Make sure that you have a good Wi-Fi connection if that's how you're going to connect to it, which a lot of people don't. So we're going to, you know, this is going to highlight some of the disparities in care. We're hearing that more and more right now with people who have long had poor access to healthcare. They're not doing very well when they get sick with COVID-19 compared to those who do have good medical care. We're going to see people that don't have the technology, the devices, the connectivity to actually do these visits. So we're going to have to address that as well. And then we just do a visit. So right now, you know, if it's a new patient, I introduce myself. You know, we talk about, you know, we get verbal consent that we're going to, you know, give medical advice over the telephone or over video. We make sure that nobody's going to record either portion of it without talking to the other person, getting consent first. We make sure that, you know, who's all in the room with you so that everybody's present and accounted for. And then there's always the caveat that I may receive incomplete, information from you that may impact my ability to provide accurate medical information, and or we may be disrupted from a technology aspect. Are you willing to accept those risks?
And how often does that happen?
Consent process.
How often does that happen that the technology fails in the middle of a video call?
Yeah.
I guess you've always got the option of a backup by phone, but is that like something that happens a lot? Certainly, as I've tried to use some of these platforms to communicate with friends, as we're all sheltering in place, very frequently there's some kind of a technological hiccup.
It can be a little glitchy, especially if you're not used to it or if your connection is poor. It's interesting right now, everybody's streaming everything, right? So, I'm doing these visits from my home office. So I'm in my office. My school-aged children, 7 and 10, are in the other room doing their remote learning for school, which is done on their iPads. So they're accessing Wi-Fi. My wife is a pediatric emergency room physician, so she's working from home as well for a lot of her administrative things. So we're all trying to get into the same bandwidth at the same time. So that can interrupt things on my end. And you have the same exact scenario on the other end. You have parents with multiple kids at home and their kids are doing things on Wi-Fi while they have, the one child, is trying to do the video with me. So that can be a little glitchy, but we get creative. Yesterday I had a call where the video worked just fine. For whatever reason, they couldn't hear me. I could hear them just fine. So I picked up the phone and I called them. So I put them on speakerphone while I kept the video up, and it was real time and it worked out just great. So you just kind of improvise, I should say, and you have to be flexible with it.
I want to go back to something that you said during your previous sort of answer about how these appointments go. And you said that this is going to highlight healthcare disparities, that the same folks who are being affected, populations of low socioeconomic status. I mean, we've certainly seen that certain populations of color are both contracting and are dying of COVID at higher rates. So this is highlighting important health and healthcare disparities in our culture. Those same folks may be disproportionately affected by not having a good internet connection or not having a computer that is fast enough or new enough to do a video call. I'm sure you don't have any kind of a magical answer to this question, but what would you suggest if someone's listening and is in that position and needs to see their physician? Any general advice for them?
Yeah, telephone, I think is always an option. So make the phone call. Try not to assume anything. So at least call and see what the options are. And a lot of times, on our end, we can just hop on the phone and ask the same questions that we would ask in the office or by video. And that helps us, figure out what the most likely diagnosis is, and we can discuss treatment options and at least arrange follow-up and things like that. So if you can get access to a phone in some way, shape, or form, that's the way to go. As we get out of this, and I think, after we're done with this global pandemic and the social distancing measures, which may take months to, who knows how long, but telemedicine is going to be here to stay. We've overcome a lot of these early barriers, and we're going to expand this. And one nice option, especially in rural communities, is there can be, say, a primary care office where they actually have patients come in, and they have the equipment and the technology there. So the patient's there, the technology's there, and you even have a nurse or physician there, and then they call me remotely. So I can provide care to somebody across the country or in another part of my state. So that's another form of this telemedicine that works out great. So that person doesn't have to have access to the technology. They just need to find a way to get to that office that does.
It's a great, great point. To change the subject slightly, but not entirely, because you mentioned reaching out across the country, I mentioned when I introduced you that you're very active in social media. And I think I just checked and it looks like you have something like 20,000 followers on Twitter. And you've been using social media, I think, for a pretty long time in a professional context. And my impression is that's still relatively unusual for physicians to take to Twitter in the way you have. Why did you decide to do this? And what role do you think Twitter and other social media platforms are playing in getting accurate medical information out to the public in general, but particularly right now, maybe about coronavirus, yes, but also about other medical issues.
Yeah, the same reason that I got involved in social media back in 2013 is the same reason that I continue to stay engaged now. It's because of all the misinformation that's out there. And we know that, you know, the vast majority of people have, you know, they go online in some way, shape, or form. And about 3/4 of people actually look for health-related information, either for themselves or loved ones, online. So they're searching online for information about their own health. You know, what are my symptoms, or what do these symptoms mean, I should say, things like that. And when you just use the typical search terms and search tools that a lot of people use, search engines, I should say, you know, the information that comes back, it's not regulated. Nobody's out there saying, oh, this is true, this one isn't true. So anybody can put anything they want online. And for a lot of people, it's a really scary place because you're going to get bombarded with tons of information. And the information is often incorrect, sometimes deliberately incorrect, because there's a lot of people that are trying to sell miracle cures and treatments that don't actually exist, and they're trying to profit from it. A lot of times it's innocent misinformation because people mean well, and they use their own personal anecdotes, and they say, this worked for me, therefore it should, you know, you should do this. But people don't realize that their personal story may not apply to anybody else, and it doesn't constitute evidence. So that's the main reason I got involved. And we are seeing more and more medical professionals go online and use platforms like Twitter and Instagram, things like that, to really reach people, because that's where our patients are going. That's where the general public is going for their information. We recognize the amount of misinformation out there. We want to be trusted, vetted resources for people to go to. We can't, you know, give individual medical advice online. You're not my patient. Even if you are my patient, I can't tell you, you know, I can't give you advice on Twitter or Instagram, even if it's through direct messages. There's a purpose. There's a reason we don't do that. But we can give resources, and we can offer perspective, and we can help people, especially right now. And we need to get people to understand how to spot a trusted resource, how to spot a fake, how to avoid misinformation, and more importantly, how not to spread misinformation, because that's how a lot of this just, you know, organically grows.
It's you've given us a lot to think about, and you've offered a lot of good advice during this, or a lot of good thoughts during this interview. Dr. David Stukus, I wish we had more time to talk, but we'll have to leave it there. Thank you so much for joining us on About Health today. I hope that you and the people that you love stay safe and healthy.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
That was Dr. David Stukus, Associate Professor of Pediatrics in the Division of Allergy and Immunology, as well as the Director of the Food Allergy Treatment Center at Nationwide Children's Hospital. Of course, physicians aren't the only healthcare professionals. People are consulting more and more via the internet. Virtual psychotherapy and mental health tools are also increasingly common. Over the last few years, teletherapy, as it's sometimes known, was already becoming relatively popular, but now, as a result of sheltering in place due to coronavirus, it has become the only option for some people. But is it a good option? Here to talk with us about this topic is psychologist Dr. Paula Wilbourne. Dr. Wilbourne is co-founder and chief science officer at Sibley, a company providing online coaching services and science-backed tools. An expert in digital health, motivation, and applied AI, she has spent her career in leadership roles focused on improving quality and access to behavioral health interventions. She has served as the Director of Addiction Treatment Services at the Palo Alto VA Hospital, Deputy to the VA's National Chief Consultant for Addictive Disorders, and National Coordinator for the Department of Veteran Affairs Motivational Interviewing and Motivational Enhancement Therapy Program. Dr. Paula Wilbourne, welcome back to About Health.
It's a delight to be here. Thank you for having me.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you. So over the last half hour of the show, I've been talking with a medical doctor about telemedicine, which is probably somewhat familiar to most people listening, but teletherapy might be less known. So let's just start with the sort of basic question. What is this teletherapy business, and what different forms does it take?
Sure. So when you think about teletherapy, I tend to think of it as a broader category, of which teletherapy is just sort of one end of a spectrum. And so when you say teletherapy, I think of basically traditional psychotherapy that's delivered through either the phone or the computer, sort of taking what we do in a traditional treatment setting and taking it online. I do think that there's actually a whole spectrum of tools that have become available, not just because of the pandemic, but that has been developing over the last, it's over the last 20 years, but it's been gaining more and more momentum and popularity over the last few years, which includes, video therapy sessions, telephone therapy sessions, online consultation over email or over text with a variety of professionals, all the way through to apps that are very low cost and inexpensive that you can use on your own to improve your, mental health or, mental wellness on your own. And so there's a whole spectrum of tools that I think fall into an umbrella of which teletherapy is just one piece.
Okay, so it sounds like, actually, much like I heard from the physician last half hour, it really runs the gamut, and that this can take the form of, audio, telephone, audio over streaming, video. I want to talk about apps a little bit later in the show, and even text messaging and email. So the next question I'm going to ask you is probably a bit broad, but as a psychologist, what would you say are the biggest challenges for a therapist of doing therapy in this kind of format, whether it's over the phone or video or text chat, in comparison to doing it in person? And also the flip side, are there any advantages to this kind of new world of teletherapy?
So I think there are a couple of ways in which I think of the challenges to therapists who've been working in a traditional setting up to this point in their careers. Historically, there hasn't been a great deal of training. So, as a psychologist, as folks who work as therapists, we go through training programs where we learn, treatment models, treatment interventions, assessments. We learn all aspects of the helping professions. But historically, the tools you might need to be familiar with to do teletherapy haven't traditionally been a part of those programs. And so I think that that's changing more recently, but even still, I think the training of traditional therapists in the newer models of delivery is a place where, as trainers and mentors, we have a lot of room to grow. And that then leads to, I think, the implementation challenge. When you go to implement telemedicine, telemental health tools into existing treatment systems, is you have therapists who are a little queasy about it. And so you can make the cameras, you can make the software available, but it's not the place where people traditionally feel confident. And so I'd say between training and the comfort of many providers, just that the initial hump of getting people to give it a try, it takes a lot of lift. I think the good news there, and you talked about some of the advantages, is that the data tells us it's a very good way to connect to people, whether it's someone living in a community where traditional therapy sessions, resources aren't available, or whether it's someone who has some barriers related to cost or transportation or stigma. There are a lot of ways that these more flexible, less traditional tools solve some of the challenges, the longstanding challenges that I think have existed in the traditional mental health system.
You were talking about getting therapists on board with the technology and the concerns that therapists have regarding technology. But what about concerns that clients have regarding the technology? And in particular, I'm thinking about questions about security and confidentiality related to teletherapy. To what degree is confidentiality, privacy, those kinds of things, to what degree are those an issue?
I think those are an issue, whether you're talking about traditional therapy, traditional mental health services, or, more modern online, digitally enabled services. And so either way, you need to think about the security of your therapist record, the professional discretion that they use in how they handle your private information. That's true whether you're seeing someone in a traditional context or in a digital online context. And so I think those concerns are true in both contexts, but it certainly is a concern I've heard from consumers. If they want to see things like privacy policies, they want to be able to evaluate the care that you're taking with their information.
Yeah, you bring up a good point, which is that people are concerned about their privacy and about confidentiality when they consult a therapist in person, right? People are afraid, well, right. What if someone sees me in the waiting room? Or what if someone sees me going into the therapist's office? There is such a strong stigma of therapy that drives a lot of concern in the world, you know, outside of technology, in-person therapy. I'd imagine those issues just sort of carry over. And it seems to me that digital versions of therapy might in a way be an antidote to some of that because you're doing it out of the privacy of your own home. Am I right to say that?
Absolutely. So I think it's kind of, both of them have pros and cons, and there is a sense in which being able to seek help from the privacy of your own home, I think, opens up assistance to people who wouldn't have sought it if they had to go sit down face-to-face with another human being and, you know, present themselves to a treatment setting. And so on the one hand, it may raise a different, you know, flavor of privacy concerns, but it also likely reduces stigma for folks who weren't going to take that step to seek traditional assistance.
Yeah, and there is so much stigma, even now, even in the 21st century, the year 2020, there is so much stigma of seeking out some kind of mental health care. I think it's gotten better over the years, but it's still, you know, very much alive for a lot of us. So let's say someone was thinking about going to see a psychotherapist, maybe before the coronavirus hit. Maybe they were feeling depressed or anxious or having relationship difficulties. And then, boom, suddenly we're in sheltering in place. We have to be at home. We're a bit afraid to go out. Do you have any suggestions for them? And how would they know if it's right for them to do some kind of teletherapy? And how would they go about finding a teletherapy provider?
I definitely want to talk about that. I think there's an analogy here that fits sort of with the last question, the question you're asking now. It's like, you know, what does it mean to seek assistance in this new format? The analogy that occurs to me is that if you had said to me 20 years ago, you know, you're going to go on your phone and you're going to check your bank balance and you're going to pay your bills. I would have been very queasy of like, oh, maybe I am and maybe I'm not. And there's just a level of comfort that people have gotten to expect on their phones. Like, I expect to be able to, you know, with my watch, I can take an EKG and I feel comfortable doing those things. And so I think there's a culturally, we're at a different point so that people are, you know, having the expectation of being able to seek assistance in more convenient digital ways. I think that's just a truth about where we are as a community.
Sure.
Now, to your specific point about, you know, how does someone go about looking for that assistance, I think, you know, taking a self-assessment of, you know, what is it that I need help with and how debilitating of a concern this is. Because I do think there's instances where, you know, a traditional medical assessment is what's needed. And sometimes a provider is going to ask you to come in for treatment if your life's in danger, for example. If someone is suicidal, a threat to themselves, a threat to someone else, experiencing, you know, severe trauma, or say, you know, for is in a domestic violence situation where their, you know, their safety is at risk. I think those are the situations where someone's going to find themselves either, you know, looking for a face-to-face provider or fairly quickly referred to one, because those medical needs that I think of as having to do with sort of your safety of your existence and being need medical treatment. Now, let's say you're someone who's frustrated with their spouse, they find themselves spending more time at home with them than they have before the pandemic, and they need some problem solving around communication or some problem solving around time management. Now, that's not a threat to a person's, you know, well-being. It can be very, very frustrating. It can be very, you know, stressful, but it's not necessarily something that needs medical treatment. It might need a trick or a tool or a solution that could end up being something far different than telemedicine or, you know, teletherapy. It could be, you know, an app that helps with communication skills, or it could be an app that helps with time management or problem solving. And so it's really taking that self-assessment of, is this something that's a threat to my health or well-being, or is this something where I need a tool that I can use on the fly at my own convenience? And, you know, realizing, well, what kinds of things have helped me in the past? If I'm a person who likes to write things down, I may want to, you know, a tool that helps me keep track of my progress on a daily basis. And so thinking about the severity of the issue and then the conveniences or the things that you found helpful in the past, so, I would start looking for those things.
So I want to talk about apps in a second, because there are so many of them. But just thinking about, like, teletherapy itself, so, like, something that looks like traditional therapy, but perhaps it's over the phone or perhaps it's over video. If someone has determined, yeah, I think my problem is severe enough that I really do think I need some therapy, do they just do what they would normally do, which is to Google around, find a therapist, give them a call or an email and ask, do you do teletherapy, or are there other ways to find a teletherapist?
See, one of the things when I give people, you know, when people ask me this question, the first thing I say is, you know, well, what resources do you have? And so one thing I'm aware of is that many employers pay for services related to, like, an EAP, or there are new companies in the marketplace that, you know, so one example would be Lyra or Talkspace. There are, or BetterHelp. There are services that are often paid for by employers that you may have available to you that you may not be aware that you have available to you. So I always recommend folks think about, you know, what's cost effective, what resources, you know, are most accessible to them. So I often say, you know, start by, you know, looking into the benefits that you have available through your employer. If that's not an option that's available, then I would absolutely go online, start looking, asking the questions you'd ask a therapist normally about, you know, how they work with people, what kinds of things they specialize in. One of the things that is important to me as a provider is do they use the tools that science tells us are effective? And so I would be shopping for someone who maybe is paid for by my employer, someone who is in my community who has expertise in an area that concerns me, and are they using the empirically supported tools that are likely to help me get better? And then, of course, you can add on to that list of questions, you know, do you work with people remotely? Can you start seeing someone who's a new client by exclusively working with them over video or phone?
Yeah, I always tell people, you have the right to ask questions. And when you contact a therapist for the first time, and there are lots of search engines out there, there's Psychology Today, for instance, is one that a lot of people use. But you have the right to send them a list of questions. And among those questions is, you know, do you work well via phone or via video? And do you have the software to do that? I also wanted to mention that some of these services that you mentioned, like Talkspace, like BetterHelp, I'm in no way endorsing them, just to name a couple. They also, it's not just employee sponsored, but you can actually pay out of pocket for those. And I think they even have, like, different levels of service to fit different people's needs. Well, you're listening to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, and I'm speaking with Dr. Paula Wilbourne, psychologist and expert in digital health, and one of the co-founders of Sibley, a company that does online coaching and telehealth. And we're talking about telehealth or telemental health, particularly in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. Just as a reminder, because this is a recorded interview, we're not able to take calls today. So, Dr. Paula Wilbourne, you've been mentioning apps a few times as an option for people in lieu of or even in addition to traditional in-person therapy or even teletherapy. So we've seen the rise of dozens, maybe hundreds, of mental health and wellness apps over the last 2 or 3 years. Listeners probably are familiar with at least some of them, particularly the ones having to do with meditation, like Headspace or Calm or Daily Habit. But there are also numerous others for stress relief, anxiety, trauma, depression, anything you can imagine. Let me start talking about this just with a general question. What role do you think these apps play for mental health? I mean, what are some reasons why someone might choose to use an app instead of seeking out some kind of interactive therapy, whether it's in person or by video?
You know, I think about, you're absolutely right. There are hundreds of apps out there. And in a sense, the parallel that comes to my mind is that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of self-help books out there. And so we've always, as a culture, had a variety of ways in which we seek assistance and we look to improve ourselves or improve our lives. And so definitely going to a medical provider, especially if you're experiencing a debilitating concern, that's an important way of doing things. But it's only one of the modes. And so one of the modes in which we get assistance. So I think of these apps as, you know, parallels to self-help books. And if I'm going to be consuming, or if I'm going to be recommending a self-help resource for someone, I think about, again, I go to the science. I go to the science of, you know, I want to filter for empirically supported tools for the things that are concerning me. That's always a piece of it that's important. I think about, paying attention to cost. So if someone is adding a tool to a repertoire that they have in place for themselves, I'm going to be thinking about, you know, especially if they're using a tool that maybe doesn't have the science behind it, that, you know, you'd like to see there. I don't want them to think, oh, this is, I would hate to see someone using a tool that hasn't been empirically supported if it prevented them from accessing something that they think might be more effective, if that makes sense. And so I always want people to go to the most effective thing for their situation.
How would they know? How would they know what that is? So you and I, we're both psychologists, and we have been trained for years, right, to seek out evidence,
absolutely,
to look in scientific journals. Do you have any tricks for, let's say I'm looking into an app and I'm thinking, I wonder if this has some evidence behind it that it actually is effective, that it actually works? I mean, one of the things that I've noticed is when you go to the website for those apps. So you go to the company that produced the apps. Sometimes, you know, at the very bottom of their page, along with the contact me link and all of that stuff, they'll have a little link that'll say research evidence. And so I find myself sometimes clicking in there and just giving it a once over to see whether they've done any research to find out whether their tools work. Do you have any other suggestions or want to elaborate on that?
You know, I love the idea of going to go to the company's website, see what they've written about themselves. Do they reference scientific research for the tool, for the methodology that they've implemented? Have they done research on the effectiveness of their tool? Can they speak to that? And then I think this is a place where we all find ourselves when we're looking at evaluating some intervention that we're considering trying, is that we have to be wise consumers of information. So Google Scholar, these are tools that are broadly available. I think if I were, I might look for experts in my community and see if they had recommendations, look for experts in publication to see what they recommend. I think in many places in the world, you'll find things like CBT or mindfulness or motivational interviewing mentioned as empirically based tools, but that's certainly not an exhaustive list. And so we do ourselves a favor when we can spend some time researching the likely effectiveness, or you can either research it yourself or look for a local expert who might be able to help you, guide you towards the tools that are most effective.
Good suggestion. How else, besides the research evidence, there are these reams of apps out there. I just did a quick search on my Android phone. I went to the App Store and I put in psychotherapy and I put in mental health. This was just yesterday. And I got so many, I couldn't count them. I mean, just pages and pages of them. Any tips for how people can go about just choosing one to start with? I mean, part of it is doing a little bit of research as to find out whether it's sort of scientifically valid, that it has research behind it. But any other tips for just kind of sorting through them and deciding what might be right for you?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. And I think, you know, the way I encourage folks when they're seeking a therapist and when they're seeking a digital tool is to be, you are a consumer. And what I mean by that is you get to be an evaluator. If you went to get this is not the best analogy, but let's say you went to get a haircut. And you would get that haircut, and then you'd look in the mirror afterwards, and you'd say, does that work for me? Do I like it? What that person needs to communicate with? And it's certainly a different power differential than you experience when you're going to a therapist, but the same idea that you are the person who knows yourself best. If you go into someone's office, if I were seeking a therapist and I felt like they treated me with respect, I felt like we had a good ability to communicate. They were clear. They were tidy with the appointment. Like, there'd be a number of things I would be thinking of, like, yeah, I think this might work for me. Or if they rubbed me the wrong way right away, I'd think twice about going back. And I think the same thing is true with a digital tool. I would say, you know, was it easy to use? Was it understandable, the concepts it was trying to convey to me? Did I give it a try and say, you know what? You know, I like using a to-do list first thing in the morning and having it remind me to you know, drink some water or whatever my goal is for that particular tool. Yeah, I like that. Or, oh gosh, those push notifications were super annoying all day. It kept bothering me. I'd be like, oh no, I can't stand it. And so be the consumer who says, you know, you shouldn't assume that every tool is effective and there's something wrong with you if it doesn't work for you. Like, instead, just go in and say, you know what, I'm looking for something that works for me. Did this, you know, fit for my way of thinking about myself? Did I feel like it was a valuable use of my time? Did the tips that it asked me to implement, I could give them a little bit of a try, you know, give it 2 or 3 days or give it kind of like with sessions of therapy. I think, you know, give it 1 or 2 sessions and then really think about how far you want to go down this road.
Yeah, I always say that to people, you know, when we're not in the midst of coronavirus, and people ask me, as a psychologist myself, people ask me all the time, how do I know if a therapist is right for me? And what I tell them is you probably won't. You can only know so much by looking up that person online, reading their profile, talking with them maybe on the phone, sending them an email. You probably won't know till you're sitting across from them. And I always say, give it 2 or maybe 3 sessions. And then at the end of those sessions, ask yourself, does this feel right? Do I feel like I might be able to make progress with this person? And it sounds like you're saying the same thing for really any mental health tool, whether that's an app or whether it's a self-help book. Try it out, give it a real shot, and then step back and say, how does this feel? Am I getting that right?
That is absolutely true. And I think that the other thing I figure in with an app or even a self-help book is that what cost? Is this preventing me from doing something else that I think might be more effective? Or is this at just the right level of like financial and time investment that I think this is going to give me some bang for whatever investment I'm making in it? So I think that's the other dimension I would consider when I'm considering a self-help tool or an app or something like that.
Yeah, it's a really, really good advice. Well, you're listening to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, and I'm speaking with Dr. Paula Wilbourne, psychologist and expert in digital health. And as a reminder, because this is a pre-recorded show, we're not able to take calls today. So we're kind of coming to the end of the hour. We have about 3 minutes left, but I wanted to put a question to you about the future of psychotherapy. And future questions are always, forecasting questions are always fraught and difficult to answer. But I really wanted your read on it. Psychotherapy, you know, has already been changing, even before shelter in place. Personally, I don't think traditional in-person therapy is going anywhere. But I do think we're going to see more and more online options in the future. Like I said, we only have a couple minutes left, and obviously this is a big question and impossible to answer. But if we could travel forward in time, say 20 years into the future, and we could see what mental health care looks like in the U.S., what do you think it would look like, or even what would you like it to look like?
That's a great question. I think about how much my own digital life has changed in the last 20 years. You know, I never anticipated that email and Hangouts and Zoom were going to be so core to how we all work. And I think the same, you know, exponential change is what we can expect in healthcare. I think the things that we can expect are better access, meaning that digital tools make things more accessible to more people who live in different places. I think we can anticipate more cost-effective solutions. So I completely agree with you that, you know, in-person therapy is important. It has a place in the world. I think that there's lots of folks with more mild to moderate, just life optimizing challenges that don't need that level of intervention. And so we're going to see lots more tools for that mild to moderate concern. I think that the solutions that are available are going to become more personal to us. So I mentioned, you know, if I like to monitor my progress, but I don't want to get push notifications, and I like to do, you know, phone and app, but I'm just not going to drive someplace. Like, whatever my set of preferences are, I think I will be able to find more tools to meet those preferences. And I think sort of more personal and then more interconnected, because I think historically we have had healthcare systems that tend to be siloed. And so if I'm working on, say, a weight loss goal or diabetes management with one provider, and I'm working on my mood and anxiety with another, and I'm working on professional development with a coach, you know, with a professional coach, we will see more holistic care, so more integrated solutions, so that I'm not having to work in isolation and then reconcile those resources on my own, but that the system will be more capable of personalizing and integrating resources for the concerns that I as an individual experience.
Yeah, it sounds like a great future. I know that there's a lot of time between now and 20 years from now, but perhaps I will check back with you in 20 years. We'll have you on the show in 20 years.
I look forward to it. And we'll
go through the checklist and see if we've been able to accomplish all of those as a profession. Well, Dr. Paula Wilbourne, thank you so much for joining us today on About Health. I really appreciate your insight and inputs on this topic.
Happily.
That was Dr. Paula Wilbourne, psychologist, expert in digital health, and co-founder and chief science officer at Sibley. And, of course, that brings us to the end of another hour. I sincerely hope that something in our conversations today has been truly useful to you, particularly during this trying time of coronavirus. I'm David B. Feldman. If you'd like to find out more about me, you can visit my website, davidfeldmanphd.com, all one word. If you'd like to hear this episode again or listen to any of our past episodes, you can find them on kpfa.org. Just select About Health under the Programs page. And of course, I hope you'll continue to join us here each week as we explore important issues impacting your health. From all of us here at About Health, may you be healthy, happy, and wise. Thanks for listening.
If you are feeling isolated and you would like some emotional support, the Mental Health Association of San Francisco is running a non-emergency emotional support warm line. They've got people who are available to talk with you over instant message or over the phone. That number is 855-845-7415. And that is available to people anywhere in California. Again, that is the non-emergency emotional support warm line at 855-845-7415. The National Suicide Prevention Hotline, which is an emergency number, is at 1-800-273-8255. Remember to be kind to each other and to be kind to yourself.
Tune in Monday through Friday starting at 3 p.m. for your daily digest of independent analysis, investigation, and activism on Rising Up with Sonali, followed by news, views, and hip-hop on Hard Knock Radio at 4. Then it's hard-hitting frontline investigative reporting on flashpoints at 5, followed by a comprehensive wrap-up of the day's news and events with the Pacifica Evening News at 6. That's weekday afternoons starting at 3 p.m. on KPFA and kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.